So welcome back aliens, this is Navin Reddy from Talisco Learnings, and in this video we'll talk about prototype design pattern. So we have talked about creational design pattern, right, where we have factory, this is the second one. Now when to use what? When you have two design patterns which is used for object creation, you can use factory and you can also use prototype, but when to use what? So if you want to create an object, factory is the best way. But then, you know, there are certain scenarios where you want to create an object and object creation takes lots of memory, or maybe it takes lots of time for creation. Let's say if you want to create an object and that object is created with the help of database, because if you want to load some initial values, so if the object is getting created with some initial values and those values are coming from database, it will take some time, right? And of course when you create an object it will take some time. But let's say if you want to go for the second object, then why to create a new object which is communicating from the database? What if you have an object here which is created from the database, the second object can be created from this object, right? Can you just fetch the first object data into a second object? Something like copying the object or something like cloning the object, right? So if you can clone the object, that is called as prototype design pattern, where you can, instead of creating a new object from the database, you can actually use a cloning concept, right? Because if you clone, you don't have to interact with database again, right? You can simply create an object, you can create a copy of that. It's that simple, right? So let's try to do that. Let's see how to implement that with an example. So what I will do is I will just create a new project. So I will say new project, and I already have a project here. We'll create a new file here and we'll say this is, okay, let's go for a new package altogether. Let's right click new class, okay, and in this class we'll mention the class name as demo, because I just want a main method here, okay. And okay, so let's remove this demo. We'll use a package name as prototype, because we are using the prototype design pattern. Let's click on finish. So we have this main class, right? Let me just delete this part. So what I want here is, let's take an example of bookshop. So let's say if you want to open a bookshop, so every bookshop has books, of course, right? So book is a component in a bookshop. So if you want to open a bookshop, you need lots of books, right? Now those books will be coming from the data warehouse. It will take some time, not data warehouse, the book warehouse, right? So it will take some time, right? Now if you want to open a new bookshop, okay, what you can do is you can simply create a clone of this bookshop. So you know, just copy paste. It is not possible in real world, but it is possible in virtual world. Let's try to do that. So what we'll do is, let's create a book first of all. So we need a book class here. So I will say a class book. Now this book class will have, let's say, two parameters. Just for the use, we'll say private int bid, which is book id, and then private string bname. So we got these two variables here, and then to access those two variables we need getter and setter. So we'll right click source, getters and setters, will select both these variables here, click on OK, you got your book class, right? And let's also use a toString method if you want to print this object. So we'll say source toString, which will take this two, and that's done. So we have created the book class. Now what I want is the bookshop class, because a bookshop, we want to open a bookshop, right? So we'll right click and say new class, and we'll name this class as bookshop. We'll click on finish. Now this bookshop, what it will have is, every bookshop has a name, right? So let's have a name variable here. We'll say public private string name, okay, and then every bookshop will have, in fact this should be a, let's say name, or we can also have shop name, that will be more better, right? So we'll have a shop name, and then let's have one more, which is the list of books. So bookshop will have a list of books. So it will be of type book, and it will be books equal to new, add a list. So that is add a list, and that's it. So we got books here, and to access these two variables, what we need is getters and setters. So we'll right click here and say source getters and setters for these two. Let's select all and click on OK. And then let's also have a toString method, just if you want to print this object anywhere. So we'll say not getter setter, but toString. So right click source getters and setters, which is here. And why I'm doing getter setter every time? It should be toString, right? So we'll say toString and click on OK. So we got toString, we got books. So what I want here is I want to, okay, so let's create object of books here. And that's simple, right? Not books, but bookshop. So we'll say bookshop, and we'll say BS equal to new bookshop. Okay, so we got bookshop there, and now let's print this object. Let's see if it is working or not. So I will simply print this object, okay, nothing else. Let's run this. You can see we got the output, but the name of the bookshop is, I mean, the shop name is null because we have not assigned this name here, and then books is empty. I don't want a bookshop like this, right, which doesn't have a name and doesn't have a book list there. So what I will do is, before printing, I should assign the value. So I will say, okay, how to assign the value now? There are multiple ways. You can assign the values from here, or let's say I want to fetch the data from the database. So all the book names will be coming from the database. So what you can do is, you can create one more method here, which is, let's say, right click, source, or not source, let's create a method by ourselves, let's say public, we'll say void, and let's say this will say load data, that's your method name. Now what this method will do is, it will add the data to your bookshop, not the book name, because book name you can set it from here. You can say bs.set book name, you can set that, shop name, you can set the shop name as novelty. I mean, you can have any book name, bookshop name. I just have this shop near to my office, so I'm going for that name. Okay, so, but what about loading the data, loading the book names? So what you can do is, in your bookshop, you have this load method, and you will do the database connection, and you have to write those 7 steps, and you will fetch all the books from the database. But let's say if you don't want to go for database connection, because it will take some time, right, because to write those code, for demo purpose, we will add those data by ourselves, okay? But just imagine if that is coming from database, how it look like. So let's use a for loop, because I want to add lots of books. I want to add 10 books at least. So I will say 10, and then i++, I want to have 10 books. Every time this loop runs, I want to create object of book. We'll say book b equal to new book. And then we'll set the values for that. We'll say book.setbid as i, and b.setbName as book plus i, right? So it will be having book 1, book 2, book 3 as names. And once you got the books, you can simply add those books into your collection. So you can say get books, which will give you the collection of books, which is the list of books. You can see we have list of books there, right? So we have list of books, which we can fetch those books with the help of get books. And then we can say add, and you can mention the book name, which is b. Right, so it will add 10 books into your thing, and from demo what you can simply do is, you can say bs.loadData. So once you say load data, it will add all the books there. And now if you run this, you can see we got the shop name as novelty, and then we got all the book names here. You can see the list here, right? So we got all the book names. It's that simple. But then where is the prototype design pattern here? Nothing, we have not done yet, right? So what I want is, just to show you the power of prototype design pattern, what I will do is, I will create one more book shop. I will say book shop object. We'll say bs1 equal to new book shop. Okay, so this is your new object. And of course, if you print this book shop, you will get the same output, which is blank, right? If I run this code, the first line you will get all the data. The second line you can see it is null. We have not specified the name. Let's do that. We'll say bs1.set book shop name. I will say the shop name as a1. Okay, that's your shop name. So you can see we got two shops here, two bookshop, one with novelty, one with A1. But A1 doesn't have a book, right? So we have to load the book. So what again we have to do is, we have to say bs1.loadData. But the moment you do that, if you say load data, again it will go to database, it will fetch data. It will take some time, right? So instead of fetching the data from the database, what if you can simply ask, hey BS, can you give me your data? Is it possible to ask the data from BS? We can do that. What you can do here is, instead of saying new book, you can simply say bs.clone. So we have a concept of clone in Java, which can copy the data for you, which will create a new object from the old object. So you can simply use clone. But unfortunately, we have two types of cloning in Java. One is shallow cloning, and second is deep cloning. So when you say bs.clone, it will go for shallow cloning. Again, but the problem is, it is not working here. You can see it says the method clone from type object is not visible. The problem is, this clone method is there in the object class, but unfortunately it is protected. Okay, you cannot use that. So the only way you can use that is by, first of all, you have to give permission to your class. So your bookshop needs a permission that you want it to be cloned. So you have to implement an interface called as clonable, because if you don't do that, you are not allowed to use that. Okay, so you have to make sure that you implement a clonable interface. Again, this clonable interface doesn't have any method. Okay, this is a marker interface. But still, so what is marker interface? Basically, if you don't have any method in your interface, that is called as a marker interface. Okay, so this clonable interface is, we are just implementing that so that we'll give the permission for the bookshop that it can be cloned. But then to achieve cloning, we have to override a clone method, because see, again, you can see it is not working. So if you want to have a clone method, you have to override it, and you can do that by using getSource, and you can see this option of override implement methods. Click on that, and you want a clone method, just click on clone and click on OK. And you can see we got our clone method and our job is done, right? And if I go back here, okay, it is giving me an exception. It is not giving the exception, it is giving you the problem. So the clone method will give you object type. I want to convert that into a bookshop type, right? That problem is solved, and it also might throw an exception. So let's add a declaration which is a clone not supported exception, because it will throw the exception if you don't do this. It is compulsory for you to implement a clonable interface, okay? Now let's run, let's see what happens. If I run this code, oh, it worked, can you see that? We are not creating let me just remove this thing. Is it because of this you're thinking about that? Okay, let's remove that, and sure, it works. You can see, even without loading the data, you are getting everything. Simple, right? But there's one problem here. Okay, the positive thing is you got the data without using a new object. You can simply clone the object. The steps are, your bookshop need to implement a clone method. Again, you don't have to type anything. You can ask your Eclipse to do that for you. And second, you have to implement a clonable interface. Now, if you look at this code, how do we get a clone method? So you have to say protected object clone, because it returns an object type. You have to say clone, and then you simply have to say super.clone, okay? So internally, it will create a clone for you. But the problem is, this type of cloning, which is default overriding the clone method, will give you shallow copy. Now, when I say shallow copy, what it means? If I go to demo, and if I change some data, let's say, after this, if I say bs.getbooks.remove, I want to remove one book with the index number 2, okay, which is the second book or third book, right? If I run this code, it will remove the third book from the first one, from bs. You can see we got bid1, we got bid2, we got bid3, but okay, it has not removed, because I'm removing that after the printing. Okay, let me just do that before printing. My mistake. Okay, you can see we got 1, we got 2, but there's no 3 here. We directly went to 4, because that means we are removing that data from there. But it is also affecting BS1. Can you see that in BS1 also we don't have we don't have 3 now. It is directly going for 4. That means it is not creating a new object for you. We just have one object and we have 2 references. So cloning is not that impactful here. But then question arises, how to achieve deep cloning? So in deep cloning, we actually create 2 objects. We have 2 different objects and they will have 2 different data. Okay, so one will not affect other. So it's always better to go for deep cloning. But how do we do that? It's very simple. Just go to your bookshop and say, hey, I don't want to go for normal cloning. I want to go for deep cloning. In that case, since you are changing the definition, we can change the return type. We can simply say, I want to return a bookshop. So once you do that, let's go to demo and let's remove this casting. We don't need a casting now because you're returning a bookshop object. But then in here, you cannot do this. You cannot return super.clone. So what you have to do is you have to create a new object here. We'll say bookshop bs equal to new bookshop, right? We got an object there. And then we can simply set the, let's not set the bookshop name here, that we can do later. But we can return the BS object name. But then this will not work, right? Because if you run this code, of course it will work, you will get the output. But the data will be empty here. Because we are returning a new object which doesn't have a value. So let's assign the value there. Since we already have a value, see, when I'm calling this object, when I call this method clone, I'm calling that method from BS object, right? That means I can access that BS object here using this keyword, right? Because that is what calling the clone method. So what I can do is I can use a for loop, and we can fetch the value from BS object, and we can put that object into new object. So how do we do that? We'll say book B colon get books. Now when I say get books, I'm actually talking about the object which is BS in here. Let me change this name. We'll say this is shop, just to make it simple. Let's make it shop. Okay. So we can also use this dot get books. That will be better, right? Then what we can do is we can use shop dot get books dot add, and you can add B here. So what we are doing is we are using a for loop, and we are fetching data from the old object and fetching one name, and we are assigned to a new object. Then you will say we are doing the same thing, right? Not exactly. This load data is fetching the data from the database. So for the BS object, I mean for the first object, you are fetching data from the database. For the second object, you are not fetching data from the database. You are fetching data from the old object, which is much faster than comparing with the database connections, right? And it should work now. Let's run this code. Okay, we are getting an error there. I guess we have an error. And the error is with this line. Oh, we have changed the bookshop name, right? So it is shop. And now let's run this. Can you see that? We got the output, and again, we got a problem. So the problem is, okay, we are cloning that after removing that. Okay, look, what I will do is I will clone it after this. Okay, so I'm cloning it, and then I'm removing the data from BS. You can see it is not affecting your third one. Instead, I should print this off. I should print it together. Both the objects will be printed together so that, you know, it will not impact. So you can see in the first object it is affecting, it is removed 3, but in the second case it has all the data 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so that's the advantage of using clone method and doing your own cloning. Writing your own clone method here, not just bookshop. I mean, not just a list of books. You can fetch any, and you can copy anything you want, right? So that's the advantage of using prototype design pattern, where you don't create object every time. You don't create object every time which is connected from the database. What you can do is, if you already have an object, you can create a second object from the first object. If you can achieve this, is called as prototype design pattern. Just to give an example, we can think about this in another way. If you can create one prototype, you can create multiple copies from that, right? Example, when you want to build something, let's say anything, so you will create one prototype of it, and then using that prototype you can create multiple objects. This is the same thing, right? So prototype design pattern comes under creational design patterns, and we have seen the example of it. If you have any questions, let me know in the comment section. And if you have not liked this video, please click on the like button if you liked it, and do subscribe to the channel. Let others know about this channel. Do share on your Facebook profile or anywhere you can. So that's it. Thanks for watching, and do subscribe.